This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised.
You know, it occurs to me that this would probably be a lot more powerful if Drake hadn't been out of the top 10 for like 2 months now. And also if my only upload during that time hadn't been a re-upload that did not have the anti-Drake posters in it. Guess it doesn't really matter. Drake's probably gonna be back in the top 10 by July anyway. Come on, let's talk about 1983. Hey guys, Sean Fay Wolf of Diamond X Studios here, and I've got to be honest with you, I think that covering this year might have been a mistake. Before I started talking about 1983, I had made top 10 best and worst hit song lists for 2018, 2017, 2016, 2015, 2007, and 1992. That's a total of 6 sets of lists. 6 years out of the 60 years that the Hot 100 has existed. I have now talked about 10% of the Billboard year-end lists, and for some reason, I somehow thought that that made me worthy of covering this year. If you talk to any chart buff like me, the number 1983 holds a sort of reverent awe as the year where all the stars aligned perfectly to create what is almost universally considered to be the best year in the history of popular music. Whenever anyone talks about how great 80s music was, chances are that they're talking about a song that was on this year-end list. Some of the cuts I had to make to get this list down to 10, honestly, it doesn't even feel painful. It feels more like blasphemy. It's like trying to make a review of Jaws or A New Hope. I feel like by trying to analyze them, I'm chipping away at the very foundations of pop culture that I'm standing on. In the presence of the popular music of 1983, I am an insignificant peasant standing in the presence of titans and gods. And now I've tasked myself with judging the 10 best of them. Frankly, I don't think I'm worthy. But I'll be damned if that's ever stopped me before. We're counting down! Take your passion and make it happen. Pictures come alive, you can dance like New York criticism that I often make of my least favorite songs is that they are generic. I recognize the irony of the term generic being one of my go-to lines of attack, but I do genuinely find it frustrating when a song leans on cliches and sticks to simple trends like a barnacle. And the worst part is that not only do they suck to listen to, they suck to make fun of, too. There are only so many ways you can say, this is a boring song that takes no risks before it starts to get repetitive. So I'd like to take this opportunity to point out that I don't automatically hate a song just because it's generic. Just because a song has overused lyrical and instrumental ideas, that doesn't automatically make it bad. The key is to sell it. Come on, guys. let's start our journey, shall we? If there is one band in the world that can put a good spin on the word generic, it would definitely have to be Journey. Keep in mind, this is the band that wrote Don't Stop Believing, literally the first song everyone thinks of when they think of the four-chord pop song structure, which also rhymes girl with world in its opening line. Just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. And yet, I don't know if you've noticed, but everyone loves Don't Stop Believing. It didn't become the most downloaded 20th century song of all time for no reason. And Journey's big follow-up to Don't Stop Believing, Separate Ways, is largely cut from the same cloth. Not only does it use even less chords than Don't Stop Believing, but the lyrics are even more basic. Don't Stop Believing at least had a narrative to it, whereas Separate Ways mostly just throws out jumbled emotional phrases. And when there is a structure to it, the singer comes across as kind of a stalker who won't leave his ex alone. Feeling that it's gone! You hear it. You don't want to hear it, but you hear it. And so, if Separate Ways has all these problems, then why did it gain a coveted spot as one of the best songs of this legendary year? Well, it's simple. They aren't problems. You know I still love you. Journey is a band that defies cynicism. Whatever they do, they completely throw themselves into it 110%, and you'd be shocked by just how far that can carry a song. When Lionel Richie whimpers out his platitudes, he sounds like he's just going through the motions. Just thinking about you, baby, just blows my mind. When Journey sings their platitudes, it's like you're hearing them for the first time. You never love alone. When Bryan Adams sings about how he doesn't want to let go, he sounds like a whiny pain in the ass that the woman's gonna regret ever having met. When Neil Schron sings that he'll never desert this woman, you legitimately believe that he would travel to the ends of the earth to keep her safe. Not because he's possessive, but because he legitimately loves her that much. If he ever hurts you, when Dennis DeYoung gets theatrical and over the top, it's pathetic and embarrassing, even if it is fun to laugh at. Meanwhile, Journey has got the firepower in their screeching guitars to support and back up their tortured wails. This entire thing should be an overblown, ridiculous disaster. Just look at the music video, popularly considered to be one of the worst music videos of all time, where they literally just went outside the nearest warehouse they could find and spent half of the time on screen playing imaginary instruments like a bunch of five-year-olds. And then there's the band members themselves, which... yeah, nice eyebrows, mustache, hair, and everything, guys. Trust me, Journey is a band that I desperately want to make fun of. All the material is there, but I just can't. Through sheer passion and passion alone, Journey has ascended beyond the levels of cheese and into the realms of yogurt. Does that metaphor make any sense at all? No. No, it doesn't. But neither does the fact that Journey is so awesome, so guess we're even. The 1980s were not afraid to go to some very interesting places to find ideas for pop songs, were they? I mean, just in 1983 alone, we had a man trying to write a scientific formula that explains what love is, a wildly off-the-mark prediction of how people were going to react to the whole Y2K thing, a song called Lawyers in Love, which is about exactly what it sounds like, and a synth-pop cover of a 1927 Irving Berlin song about how fancy the Ritz Hotel is by a Dutch singer named Taco, who spends half the song tap dancing and which features a music video where he carries around a lightsaber cane, and is backed up by a pair of dancers in blackface who sound like this.
Trying hard to look like Gary Cooper. Come, let's mix.
And on the subject of white people misunderstanding and misrepresenting other cultures to an almost comical degree, that was also a topic covered in 1983. Twice, in fact. Let's talk about those, shall we?
He said, I come from a land of love.
For most of human history, white people have kind of viewed the other continents outside of Europe as mysterious and dangerous, but also exciting and thrilling places that really captured the imagination, almost like other planets. However, I think that 1983 specifically was actually the very last year in human history where that perception of the other continents lived on. Between the AIDS epidemic of 1984 and We Are the World in 1985, white Americans came to see Africa as a much more down-to-earth place over the course of the 80s, and Australia wasn't too far behind.
How do we sleep while our beds are burning?
Of course, I'm vastly oversimplifying this. The relationships between the continents and their inhabitants are so complex and multifaceted that thousands of people much smarter than I am have dedicated their lives to studying. My point is that, at least through the eyes of the white general public, 1983 seems to be the last year that Africa and Australia were seen as these far-off, fantastical worlds, you know, like in the way they were depicted in Tarzan and books like that. And as twin swan songs to this mentality, 1983 gave us Down Under by Men at Work and Africa by Toto, both songs about how their respective continents are viewed and both taking very different approaches to the subject. Down Under is a song about a man traveling the world, trying to embrace new cultures, but finding it difficult because everyone he meets keeps stereotyping him for the Aussie that he is, expecting him to be this rugged macho man and offering him Vegemite and beer, and not letting him experience the world as he desires.
I said, "Do you speak my language?" He just smiled and gave me a Vegemite sandwich.
It's about his frustration with the kitschy, marketable version of Australia being sold to the world, which cheapens what he loves about his homeland. This alone is a fascinating topic for a song, but even if you don't pick up on that narrative, it's still a great-sounding pop song in its own right, with fantastic production of gritty, multi-layered guitars and percussion, and the beautiful, chirping sounds of woodwind serving as one of the main hooks. Fun fact, this flute line actually incorporates the melody of the classic Australian children's song Kookaburra into it.
Kookaburra sits in the old gum tree. Merry, merry king of the bush is he.
And not so fun fact, the company that currently owns the copyright of this 84-year-old children's song sued Men at Work for unlicensed sampling, which resulted in a year-long legal battle and a six-figure settlement. Jeez, and I thought record companies on YouTube were copyright Nazis. By comparison, Africa shows you the other side of the coin, as it tells the story of a white boy going to Africa, looking for some sort of ancient, primeval wisdom that will help him understand the world on a deeper level.
I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words or ancient
apparently, the song was written from the point of view of a social worker who comes to the country to help combat the famine, but falls in love with the place in a romanticized, old-world kind of way. It's a very shallow song that, much like the people in Down Under, presents Africa almost entirely in terms of popular stereotypes.
I know that I must do what's right, sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti.
Yeah, if you can see Kilimanjaro rising above the Serengeti, then you must have some pretty damn good eyes considering that those two are about 150 miles apart from each other. Also, does anyone else find the chorus of this song to be kinda hilarious? Mrs. Griffin, how much would it take to drag you away from Africa?
A lot.
I seek to cure what's deep inside.
Yeah, this song is utterly ridiculous and simple and naive to a kind of comical degree, but that's what makes it so great. That innocence leads it to capture a sense of childlike wonder and awe that's very difficult to replicate. And of course, it sounds great. I could listen to that marimba riff forever. If there's one thing I can always appreciate in a song, it's uniqueness. And while Africa and Down Under both have very similar themes, they go about them with such different tones and approaches that I kind of see them as two halves of the same coin. And with this coin, I'm happy no matter which side lands face up. And if you find yourself turned off by the slightly patronizing tone towards other cultures that these songs have, all I can say is, trust me, it can get much worse.
And there won't be snow in Africa this Christmas time, where nothing ever grows, no rain or rivers flow.
Well, tonight, thank God it's them instead of you.
I bless the snows down in Africa.
You won't get no dessert till you clean off your plate, so eat it. Don't you tell me you're full, just eat it.
You better believe it, that I won't do anything for love. And you know it's true, and that's a fact.
Journey may be the first musical act I think of when it comes to just selling it, but the second act in that category would definitely be Meatloaf. It's not a completely accurate comparison, since Meatloaf songs have much more substance than Journey songs, but what they have in common is that they never half-ass anything. Whenever Meatloaf opens his mouth, you know you're about to have an experience.
That sounds dirty.
I'm gonna hit the highway like a battering ram on a silver black phantom bike.
And at least part of Meatloaf's success can be attributed to legendary producer and songwriter Jim Steinman, who helped make Bad Outta Hell a reality and has worked on almost everything Meatloaf has done since. While it was Loaf's job to sell the operatics of his songs, it was Steinman who thought most of them up in the first place. And although Meatloaf himself didn't have any hits in 1983, Steinman did work on two of the biggest songs of the year. The first was Making Love Out of Nothing at All, a song that took Air Supply, a band just as interesting as their name would suggest, and actually managed to turn them into pretty decent Journey knockoffs. And the other one?
Turn around.
Every now and then I get
a I need it!
Every now and then I fall apart. And I need you now tonight. And I need you more than ever.
If there's one vocalist from the 80s that I think deserves more credit than she got, both at the time and in retrospect, it would probably have to be Bonnie Tyler. It's not like a female vocalist with a more husky and raspy voice was a new concept in the early 80s, but while Kim Carnes wasn't someone I felt I ever needed to hear more than one song from, and Stevie Nicks' foray into the early 80s was just awkward and embarrassing, Bonnie Tyler knew how to use what she had.
It's a heartache. Nothing but a heartache.
She was rough. She was raw, she was powerful, and she knew how to milk her style for every last drop. I mean, this was a woman who not only shared songwriters and producers with Meatloaf, but also collaborated with the man himself, so I think that should give you a hint as to the type of artist she was. And while I also really love her other top 10 hit, the bitter, country-flavored It's a Heartache, I think the Total Eclipse of the Heart is a better showcase of what this woman is really capable of, with her voice really being the definition of perfection in imperfection.
Together we can take it to the end of the line. The love is like a shadow on the all of the time.
Total Eclipse of the Heart is one of the most iconic songs of the 80s, no doubt about that, but it's also one of the most simple. No weird concepts, no bizarre studio affectations or anything like that, just 5.5 minutes of one of the most straightforward, emotionally dynamic, and powerfully delivered love songs ever to hit the charts. And it's not just Bonnie Tyler. Jim Steinman is firing on all cylinders here too. When it's soft, it's quiet and introspective.
Once upon a time, there was light in my life, but now there's only love in the dark.
And when it picks up, the only word for it is bombastic.
I really need it tonight! Forever's gonna start!
Tyler and Steinman just complement each other so well, and it astonishes me that none of their subsequent collaborations were hits, especially Holding Out for a Hero, which you'll know is either the song from the tractor scene from Footloose or the song from the ending of Shrek 2, depending on how old and or ironic you are. But at the very least, we've got Total Eclipse of the Heart, the definitive power ballad of the 80s and one of my all-time favorites. I mean, what in the world possibly could have inspired Steinman to write something so grandiose and epic? You know what? Let's go to Lyrics Genius and find out. According to songwriter Jim Steinman, this song is actually about vampires being in love. He wrote the song while working on a musical of Nosferatu. She's fallen into a love that is so tragically beautiful because she wants to be a vampire and love her partner to the end of time. That's why she's falling apart. Okay, so if I'm understanding this correctly, you're telling me that the inspiration for one of the best power ballads of the 80s was basically this?
So that's what you dream about, becoming a monster.
I dream about being with you forever.
Forever.
So when he says bright eyes, does that mean that he's referring to...
It's like diamonds.
Wow. I mean, even decades before it was a thing, Twilight really still does manage to ruin everything, doesn't it? Okay, so I try to read and respond to as many of your comments on my videos as I can. And one thing that I have been asked a good few times in the nearly 2 years that I've been doing this is who some of my favorite musical artists are. Now, I legitimately don't know if I could tell you who my favorite band is, though some of the names that come to mind are Gorillaz, Queen, the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Avantasia, and Caravan Palace. However, I do have a decided singular favorite solo artist. I decided that he was my favorite when I was 15 years old, and in the 7 years since then, my mind has not changed. Who is it, you ask? I'll let him introduce himself.
Now, right here on our stage, BJ and the Affordables.
BJ and the Affordables, huh? Oh, Billy, you wily bastard.
Tell her about it, let her know how much you care.
So, out of all the artists I could possibly name as my favorite of all time, why Billy Joel? I know that might seem kind of strange from the outside looking in, because, especially if you only look at his pop hits, Billy Joel seems like a good artist, but not a particularly special one. And also, I'll be the first to admit that on a purely technical level, he really isn't that great a vocalist. So, with all that said, why do I love him so much? Because in all my years listening to music, I have never heard another singer with such a distinct, likable, and grounded personality that he can make shine through on such an incredible variety of musical styles. It doesn't even matter that Billy isn't the greatest vocalist, because he's right up there with Meatloaf and Journey in his consistent dedication to giving everything he has to a song. Listen to just about any Billy Joel song, and you'll immediately get a sense of who he is. A cynical, wry, humble, and honest man who doesn't take shit from anybody, and his character stays so consistent throughout his 2.5 decades of songwriting that his songs make you feel like experiences you share with a close friend, which is a phenomenon that no other artist has been able to replicate for me. Not only do I love more than 95% of Billy's entire catalog, but he's managed to take some of the most bizarre concepts for songs I've ever heard and execute them flawlessly. He once released a single about the plight of New England fishermen being forced out of work by increasingly rigid laws and competition from commercially licensed fishing companies, and it is one of the best songs I've ever heard in my life.
Like all the locals here, I've had to sell my home. Too proud to leave, I worked my fingers to the bone so I could own my Downeaster Alexa.
However, in sharp contrast to more complex songs like Goodnight Saigon, Leningrad, and Downeaster Alexa, you have the much more standard Tell Her About It, which is just a simple throwback song where Billy gives warnings out to those who might make the same mistakes in love that he has. Apparently, he wrote this song as a tribute to the Motown sound, and... Yeah, you just made this significantly harder for me to defend, Billy. Although he did later go back on this and said that it actually turned out sounding much more like Tony Orlando and Dawn, and yeah, I think that that's a better comparison.
Tell her about it the day before you leave. Pay her some attention.
Still, though, whatever the inspiration may have been, it ended up sounding great. It definitely does capture the spirit of the fun side of the 60s. And I can't remember the last time that adding more brass to your throwback song was a bad thing. However, where this song really shines are the lyrics, where Billy advises you to actively tell your girl how you feel about her, and how communication and small acts of kindness are the key to keeping a relationship healthy.
Listen, boy, it's not automatically a certain guarantee. To ensure yourself, you've got to provide communication constantly. When you love someone, you're always insecure. And that's only one good way to reassure. Tell her about it, let her know how much you care.
You know, just be sure to vocalize it and actually tell her how you feel about her. Like how much you care about her, how much she means to you, how much you love that she's in your life, how she ruins your faith with her casual lies, how she carelessly cuts you and laughs while you're bleeding, and how she steals like a thief but she's always a woman to you. You know, that kind of thing. Admittedly, some of the ideas about relationships in there are a bit outdated, even for the 80s.
But a nice girl wouldn't tell you what you should do.
But I don't think that's as much of an issue because it's in the context of a throwback. It's allowed to play a bit more into traditional gender roles. Look, he's doing it better than Meghan Trainor, that's all I'm saying.
Cause if you treat me right, I'll be the perfect wife. Buying groceries, buying what you need.
Billy Joel is typically a dry, sardonic, and often pessimistic man, but he has definitely shown himself to have a soft side. So to hear him performing such an upbeat, sincere song is an excellent change of pace within his discography without breaking character. And I'm glad this was a number one hit. It was well deserved. This is just a great sounding, upbeat song that puts a huge smile on my face and gives out some great relationship advice from a man who, right after the song was released, divorced his wife of 9 years and immediately got remarried to a supermodel. Honestly, I'm just astonished she stuck around for 5 years after She's Always a Woman to Me was released.
She'll carelessly cut you, laugh while you're bleeding. She steals like a thief, but she's always a woman to me.
Like, seriously, lady. Red flags.
Before it gets too late, you got to tell.
Oh, not bad, not bad. Yeah, thanks for warming them up for me.
Have some more chicken, have some more pie. It doesn't matter if it's boiled or fried, just eat it.
You are not the pie.
Yep, we got one Billy J out of the way, might as well tackle the other one.
Hey,
the I don't think it's a stretch to say that if you had to pick one song to represent the pop music of the entire 1980s, it would be this one. It's actually kind of ridiculous just how many tropes indelibly linked to the music of the 80s began with this one song. First off, this was the biggest hit off of Michael Jackson's Thriller, which would go on to become the best-selling album of all time. Its popularity was kicked off by Michael's performance at Motown 25, which not only introduced the world to the moonwalk, but also instantly established Michael Jackson as not just the king of pop, but one of the coolest men of the decade. The song's music video was not just the first video by a black artist ever to be played on MTV, but it was also the one which brought MTV to the world's attention and turned it into the kingmaker of the 80s music scene. The advent of the music video resulted in music itself becoming far more image-driven and by extension more corporate, which changed the record industry in ways we're still feeling the impact of today, and it all started with Billie Jean. Kind of bizarre, considering that everybody expected it to be a flop. Yeah, as it turns out, pretty much nobody behind the scenes expected this song to take off. Apparently, Quincy Jones fought Jackson tooth and nail on this song, saying that the intro was too long, he didn't like the bass line, the title was a bit too reminiscent of a certain lesbian tennis legend for his taste, and the song overall was too weak and flimsy to be on Thriller. And yet, apparently, Jones was completely cool with this being the lead single.
The doggone girl is mine.
I still can't believe that actually happened. Anyway, Michael fought hard for his vision of the song. Eventually, Jones caved, and Billie Jean succeeded in wiping the bad taste of The Girl Is Mine out of everyone's mouths, because this song's beat is pretty much as perfect as a crossover dance smash possibly could be.
The kid is not my son.
Lyrically speaking, this song is probably the first example of the more paranoid side of Michael's personality coming through in his music, which would become a staple for him as he moved forward. I've personally been more of a fan of Michael's pure dance tracks, but this one is sold by the conviction in Michael's voice. He doesn't sound scared by the accusations, he sounds firm in his convictions.
She's just a girl.
Frankly, I just think that Michael is lucky that this song came out before the internet. I mean, can you imagine the comment section under the YouTube video if the biggest superstar in the world released a song deflecting accusations about him having a kid? Because I sure can. And they'd mostly be about how awesome it is that he put a Degrassi reunion together, and or how the song proves that he killed XXXTentacion.
Just remember to always think twice.
I don't think I need to heap any more praise onto Billie Jean. It's already rightfully considered to be one of the best songs of all time, and the fact that it's not even in the top half of this ranking is a testament to just how legendary the year that it defined really was. To see what songs managed to edge it out, be sure to check out part 2 of this list, which is going to be coming soon. I'm Sean Faye Wolf of Diamond X Studios, thank you guys so much for watching, and if you ever feel like you're never going to amount to anything, just keep in mind that Michael Jackson's first ever number one hit was a heartfelt serenade to a demonic killer rat. It sounds like I'm making that up, doesn't it? And 11 years later, he made this.
You know what you did.
I do believe that's checkmate to atheists. Okay guys, not gonna lie, there were so many honorable mentions this year that I feel like it would kind of kill the momentum to list all of them at the end of part 2, so we're gonna do things a little bit differently and list half of the honorable mentions right now. Let's go.
Singing the blues while the lady cat's crying. Wow, Stray Cat, you're the real dog guy.
one thing I discovered looking at this year-end chart is that BoJack wasn't just pulling it out of his ass. The 80s really did have a serious nostalgia crush on the 50s, and that certainly bled into popular music. This particular peculiarity, the Stray Cat Strut, is a throwback to a type of country-infused proto-rock named rockabilly, a bluesy acoustic genre unlike anything I've ever heard on the pop charts before. This particular song nails that laid-back groove of the style, while polishing it up with some trademark 80s flamboyance to create an infectious throwback that I highly recommend.
Don't drink, don't smoke, what do you do? Subtle innuendos follow.
That said, if you're looking for a more familiar flavor of 50s throwback, then check out this new wave remake of Beach Boys era pop rock. Adam Ant is a silly name for a man to have.
You made me promises, promises.
And naturally, there's plenty of more standard new wave fare as well. The instrumental here sounds a bit too much like the background music to a Speedy Egbert level for me to put it on the list proper, but this song is seriously reaching Video Killed the Radio Star levels of subtle, earwormy hooks. Take my word for it, one listen, and you'll spend the next week humming a bunch of different parts of this song in isolation and completely forgetting that they're all from the same piece of music.
What about me?
A strange little sleeper hit, this is a more sentimental rock ballad than you'd typically expect out of this era, inspired by the lead singer's experience working with autistic children and seeing one particular boy getting ignored at a lunch counter. It's not a classic by any means, but the lyrics do have a surprising emotional weight to them, and there are some nice orchestral garnishes to emphasize the impact. Also, this song peaked at number 29, and for a song to peak that low and still make it onto the year-end list was quite a rarity before the 90s. That riff, man. There's something timeless about it, isn't there? This song wasn't even a huge hit, but I swear this must have been used in a commercial or a TV show or something, because it is incredibly familiar to me. If anyone can point out to me where I might have heard this before, then I will buy myself a cookie and eat it in your honor. Based on some of the comments I was getting, a lot of you guys seem to expect that this would make the worst list. Look, I'm not an Air Supply fan by any means, but this is still Jim Steinman, and damn does it sound like it. I will admit that it does go on for about 2 minutes too long, and there is one part of the song in particular that I absolutely will not defend.
And I'm never gonna tell you everything I gotta tell you, but I know I gotta give it a try.
However, outside of that, well, I described it as a pretty decent Journey knockoff, and I think that sums it up. Though I think you could also call it a good version of a Styx song without the pretension. Just go listen to this song again without thinking of it as an Air Supply song, and then come back to me and tell me if you still think it belongs on the worst list.
I remember Mama said, no, you just have to wait.
And by a similar token, a lot of you guys seem to think that this was going to be on the worst list just because it's a white guy covering a classic Supremes song. Look, I love the original Supremes song, but Phil Collins' take on it was actually one of my final cuts from the actual list, because while it may not be the most necessary cover in the world, the bass song is still incredibly strong, and Phil Collins gives what I would argue is the best upbeat performance of his entire career. If you dislike this song on its own merits, then that's fine, opinions are opinions. But if you dismiss this song out of hand just because it's a white artist covering a black one, come on guys, that ain't cool.
Why do you have to be a heartbreaker? Is it a lesson that I've never been?
Dionne Warwick is probably the most successful artist of the past 50 years that most people under the age of 30 has never heard of, and that's a shame because damn can she sing. The production here is a bit dated, and the overall composition is a bit uncharacteristic for her. It was written by the Bee Gees, after all, but I still think this is a great vocal showcase for her. Definitely check this one out.
If you're blue and you don't know where to go to, why don't you go where fashion sits? Putting on the Ritz.
I don't think that a Rubik's Cube wearing a neon pink leotard playing Pac-Man on an Atari 2600 would be as early 80s as this song is. In terms of weird, abstract, kind of twisted and utterly ludicrous pop spectacles that only could have existed in that brief window of time between Blondie and Duran Duran, this song is pretty much the end-all be-all, the ground negative zero, if you will. And frankly, I think that Putting on the Ritz by Taco has taught us all a valuable lesson, and that's that more songs need tap dance solos in the middle of them. What the hell were you smoking, and where the hell can I get some?
No, I'm still standing better than I ever did.
This was apparently Elton John's statement of purpose that he was going to keep on trucking even as the music scene evolved around him. And considering that this song's release ended up at almost exactly the halfway point of his career, I would say that he succeeded. I certainly do like the song myself, but I put it on here because this is actually one of Casey's favorite songs, believe it or not. And, I can kind of see why.
By golly, what a wonderful day it is. Don't you agree? Shut. Well, that's okay, because I'm still standing better than I ever did. Isn't that right, Mop? Well, that's okay, because I'll always be standing. Right, Grandma?